Semper 5 Fund. You know, I remember early on in the war, I remember early on in the emergence of the Semper 5 Fund, and I think they were probably one of the first and most effective organizations that, that helped wounded warriors, they helped the Gold Star families, and it's just wonderful to see that they're still moving. They're still operating even through COVID. They were able to reach out and continue to support our wounded warriors, close to our families. So how about a round of applause for the incredible. We also have the Independence Fund here today, and I would encourage you to get out there and talk to the leadership of the Independence Fund. Focus Marine and the Warrior Reunion Fund. And the reason I bring those contributors up, they help make this event possible, is because for those of you here that would like to do smaller reunions, if you'd like to do a 2-8 reunion, if you want to do a squadron reunion, these are the kind of organizations that you really ought to get a hold of today and get their contact information, because that's really what they do. They help combat veterans and organizations sit together to have reunions, perhaps on a little bit smaller scale than where we are today as a MEP. But I think these are incredibly valuable services. And I've said for years, the most respected and the most important alumni association in the world, it's not Harvard, not Yale, it's not the Naval Academy or the Citadel, those are all great. The most important alumni association in the world is the United States Marine Corps. And if you are in the organization. Traffic earlier and getting things going, and Bruce is a force of nature. She's a retired school teacher from Stanton, Virginia, and has been just unbelievably the sort of the essential piece of this member union. And by her dynamic leadership, her vision, and her ability to crack a whip when it needs to be cracked to get people moving, she does a great job there. So, Bruce, thank you for being here. Brunch, and the club really wanted to get this right. They wanted to make sure that they put out a quality spread befitting the audience here today. And about a round of applause for the people that work here. Okay, well, I'm not going to give you a long introduction for our lieutenant governor, but all I can tell you is that the most important thing on her entire resume, and I know everybody's seen her bio, everybody's seen it, and she's been the first in so many different categories. And, you know, I was talking to her husband, Terry, this morning. Terrence? Terry or Terrence? Terry. All right. So I was talking to him, and we were admiring his tie. If you see him, compliment his tie. It's tremendous. But he's wearing a Marine Corps tie that Sergeant Major Hoof and I had never seen before. So we were having a little tie-in right before the chapel service. But we were talking a little bit about Lieutenant Governor, and I think he said something that really stuck. He says, you know, she's not a politician, she's a servant. And I'll tell you, those words kind of stuck with me because we're not going to get political here today. But I would tell you how refreshing to have an elected official identify as a servant, not a politician. And so, Terry, thank you for that. We're inspired by this Lieutenant Governor. We're really inspired by your background. It was a Marine from 1983 to 1986 out at Camp Pendleton. Was an electrician, started her own company after she got out of the Marine Corps, put herself through college, and again has been very active as a public servant for the last 10 years. We are incredibly honored, and I know your schedule is just ridiculous, but we are incredibly honored to have you join us here today. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my deep and distinct pleasure to welcome and bring back to this family Lieutenant Governor Winsome Earle-Sears.
anyway. You don't have to tell me twice. I know how this works. I'm worried after all. And we say, go eat, we go eat. Thank you for having me. It's so good to be with you. I am the one who is honored to be here. I'm the one, I get to talk with you about just so many things and goals our families. We thank you. We thank you for giving us your sons. We thank you for giving us your nephews, your cousins. We thank you for doing that for us. And yes, we would rather that we had not been here today, because you're the reason why we're here. But we're here, and we want to remember. And in fact, Memorial Day is coming up soon. And they're going to be remembered again. They're always going to be remembered. We will never forget what they have contributed to our country. What you have contributed to our country. I understand, life was not supposed to be like this. I understand that you were never going to be prepared for the knock on the door. You're never going to be prepared for that. But they wouldn't have wanted it any other way. I mean, you couldn't have persuaded them. They wanted to be Marines and sailors and Army and Air Force. They want to do these things. And how do I know? Because I'm a Marine. And I know the Marine Corps saved me, actually. And how do they do that? Among other things. I tell my story. So, when my grandmother died, I was not prepared because she was not ill. And I went back to the Jamaica for a funeral, and, you know, I was supposed to start college the next month, August. I had everything ready, I had all my classes, my books, everything, just waiting to go, and she died, and that July. So I went back to Jamaica because that's where I was born, for her funeral, and I looked at her in the casket, and I thought, what's the purpose of life? If all you're going to do is just die, what is the purpose of life? All the love that she's ever loved, all the life she's ever lived. It's all for naught. I was 18, and my life was over as far as I could tell. And I told my mother, I'm just going to stay here and die, because there is no point to life. And so my mother, being a mother, said to me, well, if you're going to stay here and die, I have some goals. And I've got to be out of time, I've got to do this, I've got to do that, and I've got to do this too. And I thought to myself, well, I'm going back to America. Nobody's telling me what to do. And then I looked at the coffee table, and there was a check magazine on the coffee table. And I flipped it open, and you know what I saw? Grades. The few, the proud, the Marines. I said, yes, that's what I need. They're going to give me a reason to live. They're going to give me discipline. And will they give me another reason to live? Started at the AP station. We were in New York because I was raised in the Bronx. And we get to the AP station, and you know, you have to line up. And the line of your service. So the Army and the Navy line was around the corner through the woods and down the plane. The Air Force line was just about that long. And the Marine Corps line, there were four of us. And I was the only female. And the rest of the services were looking at us. And we were looking at them. And I won't tell you what we really said, but it was something like, what the? If the Air Force went to, what did they know that we know? Pretty good, real, right? So then fat women. And I said, sir, see, you know. And boot camp has begun. And, you know, he did that rude awakening off the bus. And, yeah, and then the sand fleas started taking. And after a while, you learn that you're not supposed to touch these sand fleas. But they're biting you. They're helping the drone suckers. And you're standing there. And you're getting bit. And you touch up. You start doing this. And the drone suckers said, and you know the voice. They'll not touch the sand fleas when it grows. Because our government issue. Lies. But you know, we've been pledging ourselves to our country for a long time, long time. And that's what your family members did. Exactly what they wanted to do. And why? Because they saw it modeled for them. I can tell you that my husband and I, my husband's parents, you heard about him. So I'm a little corporal, right? And he was an officer. But I didn't need to come to that before I got out. When you sent care packages home to us, our home? Oh, the two loved it. We love the cookies, we love the this, we love everything you sent for them. You thought it was for them? Oh no, this is the homeless. That doesn't survive. As soon as you smell that on the mail run, oh, it's ours now. So thank you for picking all that good stuff. Yes. And when babies were born, they would send out everything. When you come back to the school, you better have some cigars for everybody. And yes, I lit them up too. So I choked myself after that. You know, I'm one of the fellas, right? So we celebrated the birth of the children. We did. Sometimes they're laying in the rack, you know, talking about you, remembering you, and they're showing all the pictures. We do all that. We didn't forget you. You're part of the family. You kept the home fires burning when we couldn't be there. So you served too. You sacrificed too. We had a lot of fun. We did. And then we learned a lot of things too. We learned a lot of new words when we came in. Words like skate job. Some of us worked hard on that song. And words like flyboy. Those of us who know it's, you know, guys who fly the planes and everything else and make better than the rest of us. And then we always had, you know, those of us who were always lollygagging. And then the dog and pony show. And of course, everybody loves a parade until you have to be in it. And you're sweating, and they're telling you to lock your knees, and yeah. And then, of course, there's always the one where we talk about the blind kid in the van. We all know what that means. We learned a lot. We learned, and you learn it very quickly. I mean, think about it. The sons and daughters that came to the services, no matter which one, they couldn't even boil water. And then they come home and you saw them. They were spick polished and, you know, getting up and fixing a bed. And, you know, before you know it, they're watering you around. That's not a hospital corner. Pull that out. So, let's talk about what they said about Marines and what they said about the other services. And what I want is when I call your service, please stand up, because I know some of you are of the other services too. It's unfortunate that this is that it happens, but it is life after all. So who's Army here? And please stand. You know, none other than Colin Powell, I want to read it exactly, I have it here. He said, and you know, he was, of course, Army, and by the way, his parents were Dominicans too. And what he said when overseas, you know, they were challenging us about Marines and everybody else always fighting wars, etc. And he said, you know, over the years, the United States has sent many of its fine young men and women into great peril. Why? To fight for freedom beyond our borders. And the only amount of land we have ever asked in return is enough to bury those who did not return. Thank you, General Powell, for your service. And speaking of General Powell, we are reminded about the Buffalo Soldiers and their freedom fight. How about Navy? We have any Navy here? Oh, wow. no honor in sending men to do something you won't even fight for yourself. And that's what we learn. Learn leadership. In fact, everybody knows about IT inspections. Yes. All the services that we give. Oh, yeah. Everything's got to be so right. And here we were with an IT inspection. We were coming in, it seemed like 4 o'clock in the morning, not getting out until 10, 11, and having to come back again and doing it. Of course, you know, there was a break in between. But after about a few days, our law enforcement officer did a strange thing. He came out to the platoon. We had come back from break, and it was about 6 o'clock, and we had come back, and we're in formation, and he's encouraging us, giving us the rah-rah, why we need to pass inspection, blah-blah-blah-blah. And after he was done, he dismissed the platoon, and we went and started doing our work. Utilities platoon, you know, we had to fix the diesel equipment that we got from the Army, the Navy, and the Air Force, which was always a hand. And he came out, he took off his uniform, put on his utilities, and he worked like a dog with the rest of us. I mean, he was pushing, pulling, fixing, and all that. He got more out of us that night than he had in all the days before, because we learned that day that leadership is not something you say. Leadership is a verb. Leadership is something you do. We learned that. If we didn't know before, we learned that. How about Air Force? Anybody here from the Air Force? Crazy names. This is from 19.
And then Second Lieutenant in Vietnam said this, courage is endurance for one moment more. Endurance for one moment more. And then we have General James Chaos Max. This is what he said to his Marines. Demonstrate to the world there is no better friend, no worse enemy than a United States Marine.
The one who would have risked his career for me.
by President John F. Kennedy. And I guess, I don't know if he thought that, or if anyone thought that, you know, when we open our passports as they're entering another country, they would have enough time to read it, but it's there. And this is what it says. Let every nation know, whether it wishes us well or ill, that we shall pay any price, share any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, and oppose any foe in order to ensure the survival and the success of liberty. That's what we do in America. We don't run, our colors don't run. We meet the fight. We may not start it, but we'll finish it, and you will rue the day that you messed with America. So thank you for giving us your children, and thank you for serving yourselves, and God bless us one and all. God bless America.
And for the great state of the Commonwealth.